Our goal is to understand the canonical commutation relations, in particular how many representations we have. And since the canonical commutation relations can only be realized by unbounded operators, and there one has to deal with issues of the domain, we rewrote those relations into relations for the related unitary groups, which are bounded operators, and in this form they are called the Weyl relations. And there we are now going to show what we really hope for, namely that there is only one irreducible representation of this, which is the Schrödinger representation, which we already know, and even more, any representation decomposes into a direct sum of this Schrödinger representation. So this is the famous Stone von Neumann theorem, uniqueness theorem. Well, this is the next chapter. So it's about the proof of the Stone von Neumann uniqueness theorem. So it's a uniqueness for the representation of the CCR in the form of the Weyl relations theorem. Okay, so this was maybe formulated and first ideas for the proofs were given by Stone, but it was really proved by von Neumann, so often it is also just called von Neumann uniqueness theorem. So let me just formulate it right away. So this is the uniqueness theorem. And the chapter is about proving it. Yeah, okay, so what is the statement? So the statement is that each representation of the Weyl relations, so each representation of the Weyl relations are actually unitarily equivalent to a direct sum of the Schrödinger representations. So of the Weyl relations, or each representation is unitarily equivalent to a direct sum and since we are in separable Hilbert spaces, this direct sum can only be it can be an infinite one, but it can only be a countable one. So at most countable direct sum of Schrödinger representations. The Schrödinger representation is the one where the operator Q is given by multiplying with X and the operator P is given by taking the derivative with respect to X. Or in terms of the unitary groups, the group U is given by a shift and the group V is given by multiplying with a phase. Good, okay, so, and in particular, of course, this means if I want to express this in terms of irreducible representations, there is only one, namely the Schrödinger representation. So, in particular, so each irreducible representation, each irreducible representation of the Weyl relations is unitarily equivalent to the Schrödinger representation. Is unitary equivalent to the Schrödinger representation. Okay, so that's what we are going to prove, and we have to work a little bit for this. So this is a quite non-trivial statement, and the proof is also non-trivial, but it's very nice. And so maybe let me first make a few remarks about maybe the history and the idea. So it's called Stone von Neumann, because those are the two people who really gave maybe the theorem and ideas. And so Stone gave, at least according to von Neumann, Beweisansätze or first ideas of the proof for it in a paper in 1930. So let me quote this here in German. I mean, the paper of von Neumann is in German. And he talked about Beweisansätze, which means somehow first ideas for a proof in the paper of Stone, which is a paper from 1930. So the paper of Stone is in English, but von Neumann wrote at this time still in German, and he gave a rigorous proof in 1931. And we will actually more or less follow his proof. So his proof is still maybe the best and nicest proof for this theorem. So von Neumann is really a giant whose proofs can usually not be improved, even though they are now 90 years old. Okay, so what we are going to do is to give the proof, the real proof, the detailed, rigorous proof, this was by von Neumann. And this was 1931. Good. And the idea of the proof is more or less the same idea as what I already mentioned in the context of the unbounded P and Q operators. So namely, in the Schrödinger representation, we have seen that there is a specific vector, vacuum, which is annihilated by this operator A, which was somehow the imaginary part of P and Q, which was somehow P plus or minus IP. So there is a specific vector there, and we saw if we have this vector, which is annihilated by this A, then actually we can reconstruct everything from this. So this means what we really should do is to try to find a vacuum in any representation. And of course, we are not going to do this in this representation in terms of P and Q or in A and A star, but we have to reformulate everything in terms of our operators of our operators V and U, the unitary groups which are given by the Weyl relations. But still we are trying to do the same. So we have to find a vacuum, and we have to find it in terms of our operators which we have. So the idea of the proof is to find in the representation a specific vector which is called vacuum, or maybe several of them. If we are in an irreducible one, there will be only one vector. If it's not irreducible, there will be several of them, but we have to find those. So these vacuum vectors in a representation, which correspond to the vacuum in the Schrödinger representation. And of course, we have to see that then the Weyl relations determine everything in this representation. So from this vacuum, we can reconstruct everything. And reconstruct from this everything. Everything means we have to reconstruct the inner product between vector, we have to reconstruct the Hilbert space and the action of our operators and the inner product between the vectors. And of course, how can we find, what we are given are just operators, and how can we find a vector? And a good way is to find a vector from our operators by finding a projection onto this vacuum, by finding an operator which hopefully we can construct somehow out of the U's and the V's. So that will be the idea. So to find this vacuum omega, what we really want and what we need is a projection operator. Let me call it P. Now it's not the P in a position operator, but it's a projection operator. Projection onto this vacuum. And of course, this P we must construct abstractly out of our unitary groups. So P must be constructed from the operators which we have in the while representations, namely the U's and the V's. Good. Okay. So now that's the idea, but now we have to do it. Okay. And so first of all, maybe we will introduce a few notations. So we have the operators U and the operators V, and we will combine them into one family of operators, which I denote by W, which essentially is the product of the U's and the V's. Okay. And of course, in the following, we are fixing now such a while representation. So in the following, I have my while representation, so I have a fixed representation, which is given by operators UT and by operators VS for T and S running through the real numbers. And of course, they are living on some Hilbert space, which is also fixed. So my Hilbert space is always denoted by H. So this should be the representation of the while relations. And with this, I'm going to work. And I want to see how far I can go with this. Yeah, and so let me introduce a few notations first. So namely, I'm going to define now another family of operators, which I denote by W, and it depends on S and T, and it will be more or less a product of those guys up to some phase factor. So for all real numbers S and T, we use the following notation. So with W, S, T, I'm denoting up to the phase e to the minus 1/2 I S T. So I is the square root of minus 1. S and T are those two parameters. And then I take U S times V T. And of course, the while relations tell me that I can exchange the U and the V on the expense of another a factor. And this factor, if I do it the other way around, I mean, will be of this form, but not with the 1/2. So on the others, the other way around, I will get this factor times plus 1/2. So this is the same as e to the plus 1/2 I s t. And now the other way around, v t u s. So this equality here is just a while relation. Okay, so that's the W. So it's easier to work with them. And of course, it contains the same information, but maybe in a more symmetric way. Okay, and then I need even something more. So namely, what I'm going to do is to take linear combinations of these W's, and actually I'm integrating them over functions. So this W depends on two variables. So I can multiply this with a function in R2 and integrating this. So what I will also need are more general versions of this. And I can do this for all integrable functions in R2. So if h is a L1 function in R2 with respect to the Lebesgue measure. Okay, so let me say what this means. So h is a function on R2 of two variables. Integrable means, of course, if I'm integrating the absolute value of h as t with respect to the two-dimensional Lebesgue measure, then this should be finite. And for such a guy, we can define an integrated version of this W. So we can put now a W, where I'm putting the H as a subscript. So this is now a new operator. Of course, these W's are bounded operators on my Hilbert space, and this here is the same. So namely, this will be the integral of H as T W S comma t ds dt. Okay, and of course one has to think a little bit how to make sense out of this, because this is now an integral over operators, but one can make sense out of this, and this will be a bounded operator. And how do we make sense of integrals of operators? Maybe the best way to do this is to define the inner product of my operator with respect to vectors, and then the corresponding integral is just an ordinary integral. So maybe the definition of this guy here, So this is rigorously defined. By giving its inner, its matrix coefficients or its inner products with vectors f and g in the Hilbert space, wg. So I have f and g are elements in the Hilbert space, and here is my operator, and I'm defining this operator by declaring what this should be, and this is now of course this here, but I'm bringing the f and the g to this guy here, to the operator. So this is the integral hst, and then I take the inner product f ws, t g, and now I'm integrating with respect to the two-dimensional Lebesgue measure, and this is now just an ordinary integral over a complex valued function. So this makes sense, and because h is assumed to be L1 and my operators are bounded, one can convince oneself that this really makes sense always, and this in the end really defines a bounded operator. Okay, so all those guys here, under the condition that h is an integrable function, are bounded operators. Yeah, good. Okay, so that's the definition. And now what we need, maybe first of all, we want to see some properties of those operators, which we will use in the following.